Well, thank you all so very much, and thank you for Carmel for inviting me. And I have to confess that right now I feel like a total fake, because I'm neither a scientist nor am I a... As I said, I have no useful information in either of those areas to impart. However, the lifetime of reading science fiction and writing about science fiction and writing science fiction makes you capable of faking knowledge where none exists very well. So that's what I'm going to do right now, be ready. However, we all know that science fiction is a way in which our culture understands and appreciates science. This is just a fact. Most people know very little about organic chemistry. However, it was interesting that in your presentation, which was eye-opening, you did use examples from science fiction movies. I want to, and what science fiction does is to enable you to ask questions outside disciplinary boundaries. And sometimes those questions appear to be frivolous or marginal or strange, but eventually I think they will lead us to the very heart of what interaction between science and culture is all about. And so, you know, the first presentation in our panel asked the question of why is life carbon-based? And the second presentation asked the question of why do we believe our eyes, or maybe not? My question is, why do we watch monster movies? And I hope that I'm not the only one. When I say we, I mean but I hope I'm not the only one here. So, why do we watch monster movies? And as you see, I start not with a monster, but with the reaction of the protagonist, of the main character when the monster appears. So, in every science fiction or monster horror movie, there is a moment in which the action slows down or stops altogether. As the protagonist, together with the audience, gazes, mouth agape, and eyes wide open at the monster who reveals itself. This is a slide from the movie Alien, and this is the moment when we finally see the monster. Whether it's rising from the ocean, stepping out from the closet, or emerging from the spaceship, in this one moment, the frantic action of the plot comes to a halt. No more screaming, shooting, chasing, or being chased. No more Hollywood-drawn bright lines between good and evil, human and unhuman, us and them. Something else takes over, a mixed experience of amazement and awe, of fear and fascination. Here are more examples. That's from movie Arrival, recent movie again. Just look at the eyes, okay? Speaking about the gaze, it doesn't matter what monster is, it matters the reaction itself. Here's another one in which you can see the monster, but you would expect, honestly, would expect people like to run away screaming, and yet there is this moment in which everybody just stands still. Well, I claim that this experience, this moment, is sublime. And I'll have to take some time to explain what I mean by sublime, because it's a concept in aesthetic theory, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with, but I'll go into some detail about what sublime is, and then I'll come back to biology, technology, and monsters. So, sublime is probably one of the most important concepts, that's a dictionary definition, in aesthetic theory. It originates in the Hellenistic treatises of Dionysius Longinus. But the contemporary understanding of the sublime was developed in the 18th century by Edmund Burke and Immanuel Kant. And these theories, both Kant and Burke, were based on the distinction between the pleasurable and the ecstatic modalities of the aesthetic experience. The sublime was seen in opposition to the beautiful. So oversimplifying, it is possible to say that the sublime opposes the beautiful in the same way in which ore occasioned by volcanic eruption opposes the enjoyment of a flowering meadow. So Kant distinguishes between what he calls the mathematical and the dynamic sublime, which is really important in relation to monsters. So the mathematical sublime is the reaction to what the human mind cannot encompass, such as the concept of infinity or eternity. So the mathematical sublime is a kind of experience we have when we gaze into the sky and try to come to terms with the idea of infinity or eternity. But the dynamic sublime is a response to what Kant calls nature's might, and it's perceived as an object of fear. So the connection between fear and sublimity. And this is a treatise, this is work on a philosophical inquiry into the origins of our ideas of the sublime and the beautiful, which is all based on this distinction between beauty and sublimity and our reaction to the beauty and sublimity. And what Burke says is there is a strong connection between sublime and pain and fear. So the idea of bodily pain in all the modes and degrees of labor, pain, anguish, torment, is productive of the sublime, and nothing else in this sense can produce it. And this relates to the question which I often hear when I tell people I watch horror movies for relaxation, and the answer is like, are you okay, right? Because in our common sense understanding of aesthetic experience, and I'm sure there are artists here who can speak more about it, the artistic experience is supposed to be pleasurable. It's supposed to give us pleasure, you know, which arises out of contemplation of beauty. So how can you derive pleasure from seeing bodies being torn apart and, you know, monsters and aliens and all this stuff? Yes. Well, we can, because, as Burke says, creates sublime is objects of fear and terror. And 20th century philosopher Jean-François Lyotard, who did a lot of work on the sublime, says the aesthetics of the sublime is a pleasure mixed with pain, a pleasure that comes from pain. So the body of the cinematic monster is what elicits a sublime response from the monster movie audience. Indeed, it is arguable that this is the main reason why such movies exist. Because otherwise, what's the difference between a monster movie and a car chase movie or whatever? But the biological, and this is what I'll call the biological sublime, is a reaction to the body of the monster and what the body of the monster does to our own bodies. The biological sublime is the lure by which Godzilla, the Pacific Rim, Alien, and the innumerable imitators achieve their cult status. Everything else, the machinery of the plot, the survival, the fake blood, shootouts, are merely wrapping around this one core moment in which the full extent of the monstrous alien biology is finally revealed. But why should it be so? What is it about the monstrous body specifically that evokes sublime? Because it cannot be just the danger and the pain. You can get it from other kinds of representation. But there is something, some particular kind of sublime that attaches itself to the body of the monster. And this is what I want to analyze. And I want to talk about how this particular kind of sublimity, which I call the biological sublime, is connected to our current concern with the possibilities of biotechnology to reshape or radically modify our own bodies. And I will argue that the ambivalence of our response to biotechnology is precisely the same ambivalence of fear and fascination, of pleasure and pain, that lies at the heart of the sublime. And moreover, I will suggest that our relationship with biotechnology is not only instrumental in the sense this is what it can do for us, but it's also aesthetic. In other words, just as we're both revolted by the sublime and irresistibly drawn to it, we're both frightened by the potential freedom to reshape our bodies and spellbound to it. Right. So just some, you know, examples to elucidate this distinction between the beautiful and the sublime, which is really crucial. So this is a pre-Raphaelite painting, you know, which is very beautiful indeed. But I guess my response to it would be like, yeah, it's pretty, and, you know, so what? And this is a famous romantic painting by John Martin. And this is the romantic sublime. This is an issue I don't want to go into, but you can feel, I don't need to explain how different our responses are to those two paintings. So this is what Kant says about Critic of Pure Reason. Whereas the beautiful is limited, the sublime is limitless. So that the mind is pressed to sublime, attempting to imagine what it cannot, has pain in the failure, but pleasure in contemplating the immensity of the attempt. And I'll come back to this interesting thing, this idea about mental pain, which arises from contemplation of the sublime. So it's not just physical pain that a monster can inflict on our bodies, but more importantly, mental pain, which arises out of our impossibility to encompass or to imagine what we cannot or do not want to imagine. Okay, so this is Leotard from, okay. So this is my main point. This is our response to biotechnology is aesthetic, and it's couched in the terms of the aesthetics of the sublime, and specifically in relation to both physical and mental pain. So what I want to do is to frame my discussion by two stories of the greatest, in my view, science fiction writer of all time. I'm not alone, I say. I'm really happy about it. Yeah. So Stanisław Lem, born in 1921, died in 2006. A Polish writer, wrote in Polish. Most of his works have been translated into English and Hebrew as well. And he was not only a writer, but also a philosopher of science. So his work, Summa Technologia, for example, published in 67, is still very important in understanding our relationship with technology and biotechnology. But I want to relate to two stories, one of which is probably obscure. I mean, it's one of his early stories. I don't know if many of you know it. It's called Darkness and Mildew. And the second one is taken from the Starry Diaries or The Adventures of E.O.T. Tihi, which I'm sure many of you know. So, Darkness and Mildew describes the catastrophes that ensues when an artificially created organism that destroys matter and gains vital energy from the process escapes from the lab. So the organism is not exactly monstrous in its appearance, but what it does is pretty horrifying. It's a kind of transparent ball, like it's a giant bacterium, basically, a golf ball-sized bacterium, and it eats everything. And what happens, it makes its way into the house of the protagonist, who is unnamed, and who lives there sort of, he's kind of depressed, lonely, you know, really not a very sympathetic character. But his reaction to when he finds this creature in his house is totally fascinating. So instead of trying to destroy it or being frightened by it or escaping from it, he becomes fascinated by it. So when he finds this mysterious transparent sphere, he is seized by feelings of elation, wonder, protectiveness, and most of all, awe. He is spellbound when he sees this entity, an inexplicable state of bliss. Sheer emotion came over him. And even when those creatures are beginning to eat him, literally, in spite of all, he was fond of them when he's being literally eaten alive. And, you know, this spiders breed in his house, and there is an apocalyptic ending in which a what's called kind of mountain of sparkling caviar is destroying the house and probably the world as well. But what I'm really fascinated by is his response, this awe and elation. And it's a response mixed, you know, which is composed of fear and fascination and, as I said, a kind of transcendence almost. So, and by removing, in Western stories or movies of the same plot, the protagonist always acts in some way, trying to kill the monster or defend himself from the monster. The protagonist of Darkness in Mildew does nothing. He just looks. And so why, you know, in certain way, his reaction parallels our reaction to monster movies, because in every monster movie, the monster is eventually killed, and it's always brought back. Think about Godzilla and Pacific Rim and Aliens and all those, you know, the endless franchises of Aliens. So, is our response as the audience, is really different from the response of the protagonist of Darkness in Mildew? In his discussion of body horror in cinema, and monster movies are part of body horror, Ronald Alan Cruz proposes that body horror finds strength in the way it goes against what is considered normal anatomy and function in biological species. In other words, what makes the monster horrible is that it's unnatural. It flouts every evolutionary imperative that we share. So monsters in movies engage in unnatural reproduction. They exemplify the danger of runaway mutations. They undermine the integrity of the human body. And they confound the most basic biological distinction between the living and the dead. Think about zombies. However, it is precisely the challenge to what is considered normal in our corporeal existence that generates the effect of the sublime, which, in Pittsburgh's formulation, is generated by the idea of pain in all the modes and degrees of labor, pain, anguish, torment. And going back to what Kant says, Kant says, and I'm quoting, sublime is what even to be able to think provides that the mind has a power surpassing any standard of sense. In other words, the sublime is a pleasure we derive from forcing our minds to do what they do not want to do. And Lyotard glosses Kant's definition in a way which I can only quote because it's possible to gloss. He says, it's a kind of cleavage within the subject between what can be conceived and what can be imagined, presented. Or, an additional formulation, also from Lyotard, imagination at the limits of what it can present does violence to itself in order to present what it can no longer present. It's a paradoxical self-recursive definition, but paradox is precisely what generates sublime. So once again, going back to this idea of inflicting pain on ourselves, imaginary pain, but real pain, because it's a mental pain, we're forcing our minds to do what they don't want to do. So, in his book, The Philosophy of Horror, for example, Carroll distinguishes between horror and what he calls art horror, between our emotional reaction to an actual being or situation and the emotional reaction to its fictive counterpart. So I'm not suggesting that, you know, if you actually discovered a self-replicating bacterium in your home, you would be happy to embrace it. Not necessarily, probably called an exterminator, but we want to be able to imagine this situation. And this is the difference between horror and art horror, because horror is an emotion, but art horror is an aesthetic response. And it goes back to the Aristotelian definition of catharsis, in which we experience, you know, emotions which we don't want to experience in real life, but we're drawn to them, to pity and fear, and we purge ourselves by experiencing those. Okay, so the sublime skirts the boundaries of human freedom. We're biological creatures programmed by evolution to escape pain and seek pleasure. Our normal pleasure, the pleasure of the beautiful, arises from fulfilling our biological needs of survival, reproduction. There is a whole, a great deal of study of the biological, you know, evolutionary foundation of our sense of beauty, for example, which does, I believe, does have biological foundation, but not the sublime. Because we're self-aware, social, and intelligent beings, and we can flout evolutionary imperatives in pursuit of our aesthetic, cultural, ideological, or religious goals. So the challenge to our nature is what generates another kind of pleasure, paradoxical, perverse, but also overwhelming, the pleasure of the sublime. By imagining monstrous bodies and fantastic biology, we're not just exercising our fear, we also insist on our freedom to feel fear, to be afraid, if we want to. This double dynamics of repulsion and attraction, of fear and fascination, is clearly present in our attitude to biotechnologies, especially radical ones such as CRISPR, which would enable us to overcome precisely those biological imperatives which monsters flout in monster movies. So for example, you know, CRISPR would enable a control mutation, cross-species hybridization, and asexual reproduction. And when you look at the responses to such biotechnologies among the general public, they fall into two categories, the beautiful and the sublime, in a way. Because the most common reaction to CRISPR, or at least a common reaction to CRISPR, is fear and disgust. And I'm quoting from an article about it. The most common reactions elicited by the media were disgust and fear of human, animal, monstrous creatures such as the mythical half-man, half-bull Minotaur. However, there is also an opposite reaction, which is partly utilitarian in the sense that people argue that CRISPR would allow us to cure diseases and so on. But it goes beyond it. It goes into the whole idea of modifying our bodies and our very nature in a way which would make us monsters. So I want to end with another story. This is a quote already read. The failure, so sublime rises as a failure of imagination. When the failure of imagination paradoxically attests to power, we may not want to contemplate malformed babies, mutated cells, or our mortality, but we can do it. And doing it through the distancing mirror of the fantastic monster produces the heady intoxication of the sublime. Those are Lem's own illustrations to the story I'm going to discuss very briefly right now. And it's a fable. It's one of the stories in his collection called Star Diaries, which is a totally fascinating collection. It's a 21st voyage in which the protagonist of the series, named Ian Tichy, lands on a planet whose inhabitants have mastered the biotechnology to such an extent that they're capable of reshaping their bodies into whatever shape they want. There is no limitation whatsoever. So CRISPR, you know, forget about it. You can do whatever you want. And this is what they do. That's what they become. So you have like quasi-human centipedes, hybrids literally of a man and a wardrobe. You know, it's just totally fascinating. But Tichy is horrified when he meets a veiled monk who tells him the story of this planet. But the monk tells you that only by embracing this unlimited freedom can transcendence be achieved. Human free will, which is a byproduct of illusory compulsion, but in this very paradox lies the allure of the sublime, that we are freed because we are a product of evolutionary compulsion, and by going against our biological imperatives, we can experience the sublime. Removing the veil at the end of the story, the monk is revealed to be an old creaking robot. He too, however, has free will, but he only has free will because the industry for which they fashioned us required it. Nevertheless, he embraced both his inglorious origin and his freedom to reshape himself or refrain from doing so. The lesson that he teaches Tichy is monstrosity is not something to be escaped from, gunned down, or disavowed. In pursuit of the sublime, we're all monsters. Thank you.